جاهد في الله حق جهاده حتى أتاه اليقين. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. My dear brothers and sisters, we praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whom through His blessing we are alive today to witness a great day, the day of Jumu'ah. In today's khutbah, I would like to talk about the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Many of us, we listen to different khutbahs, we listen to different lectures, and some speakers, they sound good. Some speakers, we do not even connect with them. And the problem most of the time is not with the speakers. It's with us, it's with our hearts. Subhanallah, we have the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yet in many cases, we look for other words. There are some of us who listen to a khutbah or a lecture and just love that speaker. And one of the ulama said, a speaker or a khatib or an imam who makes you love him and do not connect you with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they have indeed failed. So today, I would like to go back to the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The words that we read at least 17 times a day in every salah, Surah Al-Fatiha. Many of us, when we read Surah Al-Fatiha, we read it so fast, we do not reflect. We do not see ourselves in the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Many of us, when we recite the Quran, we even forgot what we recited. So let us go back to the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and see how we can see ourselves. And how I pray today that we will approach salah differently, starting with Surah Al-Fatiha. بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts Surah Al-Fatiha by saying Alhamdulillah, by praising Allah. What does Alhamdulillah mean? It's not just thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If somebody does something for you, you thank them. But if they do something for somebody else, you praise them. So in saying Alhamdulillah, do not just focus on what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you. You should thank Him and praise Him for that. And that is the start. But do we say Alhamdulillah when we see Allah giving something else to somebody else? Do we say Alhamdulillah when we pray for something and Allah doesn't give it to us? As one of a Salaf, he said, when I pray for something and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give it to me, I praise Him once. And when I pray for something and Allah doesn't give it to me, I praise Him times upon times. For that which He has given me, it's somehow related to my wisdom. But that which He didn't give me, it's because of His vast wisdom. Allah saw that, even though I was attached to it, He decided not to give it to me. For there might be something negative in it that I'm not seeing. So out of His mercy, He decided not to give it to me. Is that our attitude, my dear brothers and sisters? When we see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessing others with His ni'mas, many of us, the state of the qalb, we say, why not me? And in that, if we don't say Alhamdulillah, we are questioning al-qadr. We are questioning Allah's decision. We are saying, why, ya Allah? Why you give it to this person and not me? Or why did you not give me what I asked for? So let us reapproach our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by praising Him for everything that we have and everything that we do not have. everything that we have and everything that others have. And only then you will start understanding who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and your position with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And can we praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enough? No, we cannot. As in a story, Musa alayhi salam, when was asked by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to praise him, Musa, who understood the meaning of praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, Ya Allah, how can I praise you? For praising you in itself is a ni'mah that I need to praise you for. This is something for us to stop at, my dear brothers and sisters. The fact that you're able to say Alhamdulillah is in itself a ni'mah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How many people we know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give them so much, yet they do not say Alhamdulillah. So when you're able to say Alhamdulillah, then continue to say Alhamdulillah. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has allowed for you to say Alhamdulillah. A man from Banu Israel committed a sin, and he understood very well that he violated the law from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he was trying to look for a sign where he understands that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is displeased with him. But he failed to do that. And recognizing his sin, he started questioning. Is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not aware of my sin? For I'm not seeing it in my life. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showed him the sign that in your salah, that in your prayer, you're not feeling the sweetness of salah. For you have failed to maintain that relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My dear brothers and sisters, wallahi, this is for myself first. How many of us, when we stand between the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we feel the sweetness of salah? How many of us, when we hear the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam speaking to Bilal radiyallahu anhu, and he says, Arihna biha ya Bilal. Bring tranquility and peace to us by calling for salah, ya Bilal. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his salah was a reflection of his relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala outside of salah. And his relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala outside of salah was a reflection of his salah. Many of us, we have failed to maintain that connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the first disconnect is saying Alhamdulillah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, while he could have said Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, he wanted to remind us about the relationship that we have with him. So when you're saying Alhamdulillah, you are worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For here is al-uluhiyyah. Meaning you're reminding yourself that I am the slave. And whatever happens to me is out of the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, when I'm dealing with Allah, I have to remind myself. When I make dua, I have to remind yourself that I am inferior, that I am poor, that I am in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And do not go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with that proud state, as if when you make dua, you're requesting Allah, do this and do that for me. And when that doesn't happen, you fail to say Alhamdulillah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues after reminding us of that relationship of ubudiyyah. He says, Rabbil Alameen. Why is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying Rabbil Alameen? He is reminding us that as you live your life, in this very short verse, as you live your life, remember, you are my servant through that worship. There are those who do not worship me yet. I am their Lord. So when you are dealing with them, remember me in the way you deal with them. Whether you are dealing with Muslims or non-Muslims, fear Allah in the way you deal with them. Do not try to justify any action that Allah does not allow and say, I am dealing with others. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you authority, remember, Rabbul Alameen. He is the Lord of all. When your boss tells you to do something that will violate the Islamic law, remember, Rabbul Alameen. Do not try to violate the relationship that you have with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by taking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala out of all the other relationships. So he is reminding us again, you are my servant, and in every other relationship, in every other dealing, I am the Lord of all. And look, as the ulama say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't put words randomly in the Quran. Every word is best fit in the place it's put. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to some of us it might make sense while he is reminding us that he is the Lord of all, for him to continue and say, I am also the owner of the Day of Judgment. But before that, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Many of us, when we deal with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we remember his punishment. We remember not to violate his law so he doesn't get upset with us. Yet we forget that his rahmah, his mercy, precedes all of that. It even precedes his just. His justice is preceded by his mercy. So when you think about Malik Yawm al-Din, remember that you are dealing with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. My dear brothers and sisters, I want you to remember this story. A teacher asked his students, and he said, write one thing that you are grateful for. And different people wrote different things. They are grateful for their parents, they're grateful for their health, they're grateful that they are Muslims. And a 16 years old wrote this. He said, I am grateful that on the Day of Judgment, Allah is going to be my judge, not my parents. I am grateful that on the Day of Judgment, Allah is going to be my judge, not my parents. My mother loves me dearly. But the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is much greater than the mercy of our parents with us. Have you thought about that, my dear brothers and sisters? So when you're dealing with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, deal with him through his mercy. In a hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as he was with his companions, they saw a woman who was looking for her child. She was desperate. She didn't know whether the child is alive or dead. And then when she found her son, she grabbed him and hugged him dearly. And Allah, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, seized that moment and he asked the companions, do you think she will throw her son in the hellfire? They said, no, no way. And parents understand this. He said, the love and mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is much greater than the mercy and love of that woman to her child. So my dear brothers and sisters, through the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his name is As-Sattar. As you are disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then you come to the masjid and people look at you and say salam and they hug you and they show their love, that is because of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For when you lock the door, the physical doors, while you're committing the sins, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as you are disobeying him, decided to shield you, to cover you, out of his love. And the fact that people see you for who you are partially and not seeing your mistakes, that is because of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do we remember that? When we read, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, Maliki Yawm al-Din. I give you power. I give you authority. I give you position. But at the end of the day, no matter how long you live, no matter how many mistakes or good deeds you do, you will come back to me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding us. Do we remember that? Do we remember that? And say that as we live day to day, at the end we will meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a hadith, he said, Allah does not love to meet the person who doesn't love to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he loves to meet the person who loves to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Aisha radiallahu anha asked the question that each and every one of us would ask. Is it death, Ya Rasulullah? For all of us hate death. He said, no. He said, the believer, the one who obeys Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, looks forward to meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah looks forward to meeting him. As he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was dying, he was saying, Balir Rafiq al-A'la, Balir Rafiq al-A'la. When he was given the choice whether to live in this world or to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he wanted to meet Allah because of the love he has in his heart. And there are those when they disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they definitely do not look forward to meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As one of the companions asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he said, what is my position with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? He said, your position with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the same position that you give Allah in your life. Look in your heart. Where is Allah? إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. Here, it takes us to the verse where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. Indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, the one and only purpose for you to be on this earth is to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You have no other purpose. And no, it's not just salah and zakah. These are the pillars of Islam. The way you live your life, the way you talk, the way you conduct yourself. Unfortunately, subhanAllah, the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is full of blessings, is full of opportunities. We can turn each and every ada, habit, into a ibadah, into an act of worship. You just have to change your niyyah, bring Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala into it. But many of us fail to do that. And we turn every ibadah into adah. Our acts of worship became habits. How can I turn every adah into ibadah? A scholar was sitting down, as all of us are sitting down now. And somebody knocked on the door. So one of the students, out of respect to his teacher, he got up and he opened the door and somebody walked in. Something that each and every one of us sees as a normal act. But the scholar seizes that moment and asks the student, and he said, what was your intention when you got up to open the door? The student was puzzled. He said, obviously, I just wanted to open the door and see who is knocking. He said, look at the difference between me and you. While I remained seated, and you did act, you get up and you open the door. Your intention was simply to open the door. My intention was, if the person who came was to ask for something, I would give it to him. If he had a question, I would answer it. And he listed so many things, and he said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rewards me for this, even though I did not move. When you're raising your children, my dear brothers and sisters, when you're feeding them, when you're clothing them, even when you're eating or when you're exercising, have the intention and mean it that you're doing this so you become the best Muslim, the best believer that worships Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that your children will be the best in their generation and you will actually get the rewards. This is again the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you say إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدْ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding us that as you are worshipping me, don't think that it is 100% because of you. It is because I am helping you, because I am opening doors for you, because I am allowing you to do that while many others are deprived of that. So when you are able to serve the masjid, when you are able to serve your community, remind yourself that this is something, again, you need to praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for. And you need not just try and take credit for it fully and say, Alhamdulillah, this is the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that I am able to do this. اهدنا الصراط المستقيم. And we'll go this really quick. How many of us think that they are already fully guided? If you think so, think again. لا تضمن الفتنة أو لا تأمن الفتنة إلا على ميت. And as they say, every righteous person has a future, and every sinner has a future, and every righteous person has a past. Just like you had a past, you will have a future. You're not guaranteed. Do not look at yourself as you're comparing yourself to those who are sinning and say, I am in a better position. I am better than that person. Don't say that. For you might be tested. Qarun was one of the followers of Musa alayhi salam. فَفُتِنَ بِمَالِهِ And he was tested with his money and he got destroyed. So please, my dear brothers and sisters, most importantly, as you're looking at yourself and thinking that at least you are trying your best to be on the right path, keep praying and remember that shaitan is working. And when you see others who are less fortunate than you, do not look down at them, for their future might be better than yours. So pray for them. As much as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is having mercy on you, try to have mercy on them. Do not try to judge them. Unfortunately, many of us, we think that we are on the right path all the time. And intentionally or unintentionally, we chase people away from the deen. Don't do that. Remember, اهدنا الصراط المستقيم. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we're making dua, He's answering that dua and He is saying, if you really mean it, if you truly mean it, this is the path. This is the straight path. صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us there are three paths. The first one is the one you're asking for. That is the path of the prophets and salihin and shuhada, the people that came and followed the prophets. And as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, I left you too. The Quran and my sunnah. So as you are reading Surah Al-Fatiha, my dear brothers and sisters, ask yourself, is this the path that I'm asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide me to? And to be on the right path, you have to learn about that path. Many of us, we make our own ijtihad, our own opinions, and we think we are on the right path. No, there is no other path than the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. غير المغضوب عليهم. These are the people that know the right path and they choose not to follow it. And we have, unfortunately, in our communities, people who are doing that. So keep praying that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not make you among those. وَلَا الضَّالِينَ are those who think they are on the right path because they don't have the proper education, because they're not following the right path. They think they are, but they are not. And we also pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us and not make us among those. And subhanallah, at the end of that chapter, we say Ameen. Is it coming from the heart, my dear brothers and sisters? Is it coming from the heart? أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم فاستغفروه تجدوه غفورا رحيما الحمد لله وكفى وصلى الله على عباده الذين اصطفى. My dear brothers and sisters, I really pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will guide all of us to understand His word and to start with Surah Al-Fatiha and bring it back into our lives and bring it into the lives of our children and our families. I will conclude with a very quick story. A king has four wives. The brothers, I'm not suggesting you marry four. A king has four wives. The first wife, he totally forgotten about. He neglected her. She did not exist in his life anymore. Even though physically she was there, but he was not aware of her. The second wife, she was so beautiful that he used to take her and show her off and say, I have the most beautiful wife in the kingdom. The third wife, she was smart. She had power. Whenever he has meetings, he would take her and she makes decisions. Wise ones. And the fourth wife, she kept him company. Whenever he needed someone to talk to, whether he was happy or upset, she would sit down and talk to him. And he lived his life, quote unquote, happily until the truth, al-haq, death came upon him. And as he was laying down on that bed, he called his three wives. Remember, he forgotten about the first one. She did not exist. And he said, as you see my state right now, as you see my state right now, I am dying. So he asked the first wife, the second wife, he said, would you go with me to the grave? She said, no. There is no way that I will go with you to the grave. But I can promise you this. I will wait until you die before I find another husband. He got upset. But he thought to himself, he said, I have two more. Let me try. So he asked the third wife, the one who had authority, the wise one. And he said, she is wise. Maybe she will give me a better answer. And he approached her and he said, would you go with me to the grave? And she said, matter of fact, I have already found another husband. So I'm not even your wife anymore. He got really sad, but he has one last chance. So he asked the fourth wife and he said, how about you? You kept me company. You showed me love. She said, I will show you even more love. I will take you to the grave. I will bury you. I will stand there or sit and I will cry. But after that, I will go back to my life and find another husband. And as he is saddened, he hears a very weak voice that he doesn't recognize. The voice of the first wife, and she says, I will go with you. He looks to his side and he sees this dark, pale-skinned woman who is skinny. He did not even recognize her. And he said, who are you? She said, I am your first wife, the one you abandoned. She said, I will go with you. He said, I abandoned you. She said, but the reality is that we're attached together. I would never abandon you. My dear brothers and sisters, that king is me and you. The first wife is our deeds. It's what we're going to take to the grave with us. The second wife is our cars, our wealth, our houses, the money that we're saving. It will not be distributed until we die. So that money will wait until we die. And sometimes people even wait and pray that you die so they can take it. The third wife is your position, your authority. Companies and businesses need to continue. Life needs to continue. So they will find someone as long as they know that you're not going to get up from that bed. So yes, somebody else will take that. And the fourth wife is your family, my family and friends. They will take us to the grave. They will bury us, they will cry. But with time, they will forget about us. So which wife do we want to keep? The first one. Focus on the first one. إِنَّ اللَّهَ مِنَكْ صَلُّونَ عَلَى النَّبِيَّ أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا صَلُّوا عَلَيْهِ وَسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم وبارك على محمد وآل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد اللهم إنا حرمنا من صحبة حبيبنا ونبينا محمد في الدنيا فلا تحرمنا من صحبته في الآخرة اللهم إنك آتيته جمع الكلم فإننا نسألك خير ما سألك منه ونستعيذ بك من شر ما استعاذك منه اللهم اغفر لجميع المسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات الأحياء منهم والأموات آمين وآمين وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين. Please remain seated. We have an announcement before we pray.
Assalamu alaikum. Just a few announcements. Brother Harun Sheikh's father is terminally ill. Please make dua for him and his family so that his transition is peaceful, inshallah. There's a town hall meeting where next Friday at 7 p.m. sharp, we have 13 confirmed elected officials. Please come and show your support for the political process and have a voice in it, inshallah. The Adopt a Highway program will be tomorrow after Fajr. Please come and have a light breakfast and help clean up 434 here, the highway that we adopted. Ladies fitness class will start April 6th on Wednesday 11 a.m. and Saturday 11 a.m. with Sister Nadine. Please contact Sister Naseem Latifa for further details. On April 15th after Maghrib, there is the story of Suleiman by Imam Udeh. Please attend. Celebration of Hijab on Saturday, April 16th. At 6:30 to 9:30 p.m. This has been arranged by the Muslim Girl Scouts. Tickets are on sale in the women's section after Jummah. April 9th is the EEI graduation celebration at AMCC at 10 a.m. Please attend. If you're an AMCC member and not signed the bylaw amendment ballots, Brother Atif has them. Please contact him after Jummah, inshallah. Brother Haseeb Qadri's son, Amir Qadri, is sick. Please make dua for him. He is at Shan's Hospital for a quick recovery, inshallah. And the food pantry is open every